you so much for joining us here today. I'm Hilary Pennington, and I'm the Vice President for Education, Creativity, and Free Expression here at the Ford Foundation. And I'm thrilled to welcome you to Funding Futures, Scholarships as Agents of Social Change. And I'm also so pleased to welcome our partners in this event, leaders in both higher education and philanthropy that we are so proud to work alongside. We are also honored to have in our presence donors and leaders from really around the world, from Africa to Asia, and many more who are joining us virtually through the live stream via the Ford Foundation website. So as we start out, I just want to say a couple of quick words of thanks. There's a long, long list of 15 or 20 colleagues at the Ford Foundation who have worked so hard to pull this event off. But I want to just give a shout out to a couple of special few who have done extraordinary work. And those would be Bonnie Velez, if she's here in the room. Are you here, Bonnie? She's still working to put everything together. And Victor Taveras, who worked here as an intern, if you could stand up, Victor, over the summer. Each of them brought enormous passion and commitment to this, and a lot of grace and calm under pressure and attention to enormous details. So huge thanks to the two of you. And then last but very not least, to Jane Polin, who probably every single person in this room has talked to in some form or another as we got this event started. And where is she even, Jane? There she is. So she has been my thought partner about this from when it was the germ of an idea. But she has really been the person who has put together the concept, the participants, the shape of the day. And for any of those of you who know her, you know she is a passionate fan of baseball, in particular of the Mets. So I just want to say, Jane, you have hit it out of the park. Thank you. So we are here today to talk about higher education and how we, as people who care about social justice and who work in philanthropy and in the nonprofit sector, can make it more open and more inclusive to all. We like to think of higher education as the great equalizer, the ultimate tool for upward mobility in our society, but it's become increasingly hard to ignore deepening inequality within our higher education system. If you were to look at an average 100-person classroom starting in the last couple of weeks at any of the top 150 or so colleges in the United States, only 3 students in that classroom would come from the lowest socioeconomic quartile. 3 out of 100 students. 74 of the 100 students would come from the richest quartile. Due to a variety of factors, the rising cost of college, insufficient government funding and support, and limited or subpar early education opportunities for many, especially for children of color, the makeup of colleges and universities today is becoming richer, whiter, and more privileged. And this trend both reinforces and it perpetuates widening inequality in our society, our economy, and our politics more generally. University graduates increasingly earn more and have more opportunities than their non-degree counterparts. And in this way, higher education has come both to reflect and to contribute to inequality in our societies. And I would say that this is not only bad for students, but it is bad for institutions of higher education. It is bad for the promise of what higher education represents for our societies, and it is bad for the world that we live in. And yet, the promise of higher education, its potential, has not changed. Everyone in this room knows that young people are a formidable force for positive social change in the world. But we know also how unequal access to opportunities, economic and social resources limits many, many talented young people and keeps them from realizing their full potential. So we are here today to talk about a critical tool in combating inequality in higher education and thus in society. And that tool is scholarships. Make no mistake, higher education scholarships are more important in the 21st century than ever before. They're not the sexy newest thing in the philanthropic toolbox, but they are a critically, critically important tool for advancing social justice. Scholarships represent an antidote to inequality, a pathway to opportunity, and a remedy to an unequal higher education system all in one, but only if they are designed with a certain kind of intention in mind, an intentionality. Scholarships in and of themselves cannot reach the fullest potential that they have. And that's really what we're here to talk about today. We've seen that the impact of well-designed scholarships extends far beyond individual scholars. These scholarships, of course, not only help to recognize and attract untapped potential, young people who would not otherwise without them be able to go to higher education, but they also, in the right kinds of educational experiences, with the right kind of intentionality in the higher education institutions that receive these students, help empower them to become leaders who can transform the world. And importantly, we all know, scholarships also improve higher education institutions themselves. Study after study shows that when schools are more diverse, when students are exposed to a wide array of experiences and backgrounds, everyone benefits. One such program was the Ford Foundation's International Fellowships Program, or called IFP, which concluded in 2013 after more than a decade. And it was the largest ever Ford Foundation grant. Susan Beresford, who's here, who you will hear about, hear from later, it was an extraordinary, really defining part of her legacy leading this institution. And it has helped more than 4,300 social justice leaders from around the world, from the world's most vulnerable populations, attend leading graduate programs in any university that they chose to attend anywhere in the world. And as we now know from the results of a recent finding from our partners at the International Institute for Education, and thanks to Alan Goodman and his team who are here, and this is available at your seats, this study, for the vast majority of IFP alumni, the experience was not primarily a path to individual career advancement. It advanced a lifelong commitment to fostering social change, and it offered alumni the skills they needed to catalyze such change. And over 90% of them have gone back to the communities in which they came to change those communities one by one. So I'd like to recognize our IFP Advisory Council that continues to guide the really landmark 10-year longitudinal study that we are doing to fully understand and unpack the impact of this program, and that would be three of the original people without whom it would not exist: Susan Beresford, Buzz Tenney, and Ambassador Don McHenry. And then, so, huge shout out for your leadership, but also your willingness to stay engaged with this work in the long tail. And then three other members of that distinguished committee: Nancy Cantor, David Navarrete, and Francisco Cigaroa, who is on his way from the airport. So, at the Ford Foundation, we have funded scholarship programs like IFP and others for over six decades. And we have learned a lot of lessons from our experience. And for one, we have learned that scholarships are the most effective when they are explicitly structured, as I said earlier, to find and support untapped talent, rather than simply prioritizing students with the highest grades, regardless of what kinds of schools or communities they come from. Well-designed scholarships not only give these kinds of non-traditional students a foot in the door, but they also work to help them succeed when they get there. They provide the services and supports that students need to really thrive in their classrooms and in the lives of the institutions and beyond. So over the course of today, we will hear from scholarship funders and experts on how scholarship programs can make higher education more open and more inclusive for all, and how they can be an instrument in fueling social change. We'll also hear from scholarship students and from fellowship alumni about their experiences and what worked for them or didn't work for them. And we'll have the opportunity to gain insight from past programs like IFP and current pioneering scholarship programs that we hope can help inform future funding and future activism. So to that end, we have put together a resource guide for donors interested in improving or starting scholarship programs. And I forgot to bring a copy of it, but Jane, will you just hold up? Rita has held up that guide, which is at your table. Many people in this room contributed to its contents, and you can download a copy from the Ford Foundation website, but we'll also send a link to everyone participating today. So we are about to begin. Days like today are one of the things I most cherish about working here at the Ford Foundation. This is a place that helps to create and support ideas and people, and we've done it throughout our history. We've supported institutions, we've empowered individuals, and we've helped to support and generate important ideas that have helped to change the world. So I hope that the extraordinary presenters you hear from today will inspire you to think critically, to think about how we can innovate together, so that we can really use this extraordinary tool to develop leaders who can transform the world. So a bit of guidance about the day. We want to give you the opportunity to make new acquaintances, so you're assigned to roundtables, and that is for the morning, to give you the opportunity to meet new people who are sitting with you at your table, and we encourage you to move at lunch so that you can meet other colleagues at a new table. Each table has a designated host. If you could raise your hands, you hosts, high up so people can see you. Thank you for this role. Please let him or her know if you have any concerns throughout the day. We'll have opportunities for questions after each panel, and we do mean brief, to-the-point questions, not speeches. We'll want feedback, both from those in the room and those who are viewing us on live stream, so please send your comments via Twitter using the hashtag scholars for the number 4 change, or by email at fundingfutures@fordfoundation.org. And on behalf of everyone at the Ford Foundation, thank you for your commitment to this work. Very, very much. So as we turn to the first panel, we want to just get a start by bringing the most important voice into the room, which is the voice of the students who are benefiting from these programs. So can we just have a show of hands from the scholarship students and fellowship alumni who are here among us? Raise your hands way high so everyone can see you and know that they need to find you. And thank you for taking time to be with us today. And I thought I'm going to just ask a couple of you, two of you, for a quick response to these two questions. And I warned the two of you before. And they are these two, just to get your voices and get it real for us as we start the first panel. So the first question is, as a beneficiary of these programs, what worked for you? And the second question, what didn't work for you? And if we could have first our wonderful IFP alum from Indonesia, who is at table 12, where I don't even see where it is. Budi Wulayo, would you please come and just give us your
from
thoughts?
From here or?
Yes, from there. It's perfect.
Okay. I think what worked for me, IFP has changed my life a lot. And also the other thing is that IFP, I think, has proved that the language requirement is not the main factor that determine the academic success of the recipients. But considering the social backgrounds and social commitment of the recipients, probably can make the impact of the scholarship beyond the degree attainment. And what didn't work, I think the alumni networks or association, I think it doesn't really work. Like gathering people who have organizational experiences doesn't mean that they will work together in an association. Sometimes it's just this is an association, but only certain people who work on it. So that is probably what didn't work, I think.
Thank you. Those are great observations for us. One, what kinds of support? What are things that we often think are barriers that if we're creative enough, we can look. They don't need to be, like language, as you just described. And then, of course, all of us wonder and worry about how to keep scholarships alive as they move forward and how to help support alumni. So really, really interesting observations from you. Thank you. And then second, at table 6, we have a MasterCard scholar, Lisa Luca, who is at Wellesley College. And Lisa, what's your take on those two questions?
For me, what worked for me is how at Wellesley College, when you're a MasterCard scholar, there's a lot of support for you. You get to go to meetings, and especially as a first year, I really appreciated that because it helped me to get accustomed to the U.S., because I'm from Zimbabwe, to get accustomed to the U.S., to get accustomed to the community of being in class in the US. So I appreciate that that worked. I don't really have something that I can say didn't work, but I have like a suggestion. So I really appreciate the convenings that we have as Astegas scholars. Usually we have one per year. I really appreciate those, but I think it would also help to have like sort of some regional conventions as well, not only national conventions, like so that we can have more of those. Since MasterCard is growing and growing, let's say maybe for Massachusetts we have one, and maybe for Pennsylvania we have another one. I think that would be helpful to get people together more often than once a year.
Wonderful. Okay. Thank you both.